y'all don't. Some of y'all might get witness, and some of y'all won't, but listen, let me clear my throat. Oh, have mercy, babe.
All right, welcome back to Run the Damn Ball. This is your host, Daniel Magnuson. We talk about college football. We talk about Nebraska football. Excited to be back. It's been a couple weeks. I wanted to post more content over the last couple games that Nebraska's had. I've missed the last few. But, hey, we're back. And so I wanted to, you know, kind of cover the last couple weeks of college football, like week 2 to 4, and then talk about Nebraska's upcoming game tomorrow against Michigan. And really just, you know, dive into what's going on in college football right now. If you pay attention, it's a historic season this year. This is the last year of, you know, college football as we know it, with the Pac-12 dissolving into the Pac-2 or whatever's going on there. And then also with, you know, a lot of different conference realignment happening this next summer. So excited to see what happens this weekend. We'll get into some of those games. We're going to talk about Nebraska, of course, because we're a Nebraska podcast. We're also going to talk about just what's been surprising in college football this year. And so, and also some things I, you know, expected to happen that have, like Kansas being good again, or, you know, fun at least so far, as they're, I believe they're 4-0. So a lot of different things to dive into. Let's get into it. This is your host, Daniel Magnuson, as well. I don't know if I said that, but yeah. So anyway, it's good to be back with you guys. Talk about college football. That's what I love. It's my favorite sport. The only sport I really like get into. I mean, last podcast I did was after week 1, and a lot has changed. So we'll start with Nebraska, because I know a lot of you guys who listen, that's your team, just because, you know, that's what we are. That's the team that got me into college football when I was a kid, watching, you know, the Bo Pelini teams, even some of like the Bill Callahan teams, 06, 07. I don't really remember that very well, but I went to some of those bowl games back in the day. I'm from Texas, so... but anyway, so I'd say, like, so far, I mean, what's up with Nebraska right now, right? So they had that Colorado game a couple weeks ago. That was pretty embarrassing to see them go down like that. You know, first quarter was close. I mean, it was 0-0. Second quarter, they had their chances at some field goals, or at least opportunities, until they fumbled a lot of things away. And then Shadur and that offense for Colorado exploded. So you know, a lot has happened for Nebraska and Colorado since that game. We'll start with Nebraska. So week 3, we had, of course, Northern Illinois come to town. And as my dog's hanging out behind me, we had Northern Illinois come to town. And, I mean, we lost them in 2017. We beat them in 2019, which is interesting. But I knew we were going to win that game. All we had to do was run the ball and play defense. And that's exactly what they did. Unfortunately, Gabe Irvin and Ramir Johnson both had the injuries that game that took him out for the season. I think Irvin was, he dislocated his hip. Ramir dislocated his shoulder. Two really good players for us on offense. They were going to help us try to get the 6 wins. And now it just got a lot harder. And so had a 35-11 win over Northern Illinois. Then we just played Louisiana Tech last weekend, and won 28-14. Just like one of the weirder games that a lot of people will probably forget, because Louisiana Tech's a average at best Conference USA team, and it's just not a very good team. I mean, they had some athletes. Smoke Harris was fun to watch. I knew he was going to be pretty good after seeing what he did in the first couple weeks for Louisiana Tech. But besides that, not a whole lot from them. I guess it was 28-7 until garbage time. Louisiana Tech got a touchdown, and then Nebraska took Haarberg out after the lightning delay hit, just to, you know, he plays a lot. He runs a lot, put Cheba in at QB. Anthony Grant had a big game, over 100 yards. Haarberg had a big game, over 100 yards. Their receiving game for Nebraska is an issue. We'll get into that when we preview Michigan. But overall, I'm impressed with two things on this team right now for Nebraska. One is the defense tackles as good as we've tackled in a long time. I think that 2021 team tackled really good, even though their offense was scared of winning games somehow. But this team tackles as good as some of those last Big 12 teams Nebraska had, 09 to 2010. So that's good to see. I thought they had that potential with some of the athletes they have on defense. This is one of the best tackling Nebraska teams I've seen in a long time. And so that's really good to say. I mean, they have to be the strength of the team. Otherwise, you know, it'd be a tough last eight games, but which it could be. But the offense can run it. We're a running team. And this is the Run the Damn Ball podcast. Like, what more do you want? Besides some receivers, you know, popping up, which we don't have right now. But the running game, even without Gabe Irvin and Ramir, we still have Haarberg's taken off for, I think he ran for like nearly 170 last week. Anthony Grant is a monster. We saw that last year. And so we still have him. Hope Emmett Johnson can kind of get going at running back for Nebraska. He was the number four guy. Now he's number two, redshirt freshman, and Mr. Minnesota football in 2021. So we'll see what he can do. Hopefully he'll have a role on Saturday. I know he's really young and hasn't played very much, but there's no excuses. This is college football, man. Now we're coming up on Michigan, and this is the number two team in the country. So this is totally different than anything Nebraska's faced this year. Like, you lost to two average teams. Colorado, we found out, was average at best because they got fraud checked by Oregon. And then Minnesota lost Northwestern last weekend, which they probably shouldn't have, but they found a way. So those are both two average at best teams. You could argue that they're both bad if you want to, you know, have a short view. I'd say Colorado is actually going to be fun. I think they'll give USC some trouble this weekend. Don't think they'll win, but they'll give USC some trouble. I'll get into why later. But this Nebraska team, if we're honest, has at best a 1-in-10 chance to beat Michigan. Like, they need so many things to go their way. Michigan is the prototypical power Big Ten team right now. And I was talking about this with someone yesterday, but they used to try to be like Ohio State, and then they realized they don't have to do that anymore. Michigan used to try to like out-athlete Ohio State and play like up fast with, you know, Shea Patterson, all this other stuff, right? No, they said, we're not doing that anymore. And Michigan runs the ball. They run the damn ball, and they play defense. They didn't against Georgia 2 years ago, but other games, they run the damn ball and they play defense. And the only time they lose is when they beat themselves a lot of the time. And, you know, like the TCU game last year, they beat themselves. Let's be honest. I love saying TCU beat them, and TCU was really fun. Michigan would probably win that game 6 out of 10 times against TCU, at least. They just didn't get it done. And so, you know, two pick sixes by McCarthy, that was the game. And so against Nebraska, as long as they don't turn it over, they run the ball and they just, you know, force Haarberg to try to throw. I mean, I just gave you the game plan. I just gave you their game plan. And if they can run it well, then it's going to open up the pass game. Yeah, they're – so I'm predicting Michigan to beat us. I'm just going to be fair. They're going to beat us. Can we make it close? Like, I'm going to go best case scenario, we lose by like 3 to 10 points. Best case scenario. I just don't think that – this is the thing, man. This – and I haven't said this yet. This is the worst receiving core. I'm not talking about tight ends. This is the worst receiving core, wide receiver group we have had in my years of watching as a fan. I would say from 2009 to now, I have, like, watched at least all the highlights for – I've watched almost every Nebraska game since 2009. I'm 24 years old. And this is the worst receiving room I've ever seen. Now, I know they have talent that are freshmen. They have freshmen that are going to be coming up that are going to be good in the future. Like, they're really athletic. They got some track guys, Malachi Coleman, Jalen Lloyd, you can name them. In fact, those two guys have gotten on the field. They just haven't, you know, caught a ball yet. I know Jalen had one carry against Minnesota, but this is the worst receiving room. I mean, Billy Kemp plays his butt off, but he's really small. I'm just going to be fair. Like, he's like 5'8", and like, you're not going to get a lot of passes over the top with Billy Kemp. He just doesn't have, he's not going to make, we don't have the time to protect our QB. He's best on like this, you know, whatever the slot routes are, the out routes, the over the middle, whatever, like that's him. Marcus Washington, I don't think he's at full health. I remember how he was last year, especially against like Wisconsin, Minnesota, Iowa, and how well he played there. Even against Michigan, he had some good catches last year. And I haven't really seen that from him. I don't know what it is with Marcus. I think I know he hurt his hand, and he may not be 100% from when he hurt his hand back in like July or August. So not sure what's going on there. But besides him, I mean, Alex Bullock, he plays hard. You know, he's a tough player. I like what we've seen from him. But, I mean, this is a former walk-on. We don't have, you know, Xavier Betts quitting the team that hurt. And, I mean, who else? Isaiah Garcia-Castaneda tore his ACL against Minnesota. He's out. I'm, like, struggling to even come up with names of guys that have, like, done anything statistically for Nebraska at the receiver spot. I mean, there's Josh Fleeks. We just moved him to running back because he's kind of big. Shoot, I might even pull up their stats. I don't even know who else has done anything for Nebraska receiving wise. There's just not a whole lot. I mean, you got Fedoni, you got Boer Kircher. I like what those guys can do. They're both athletic tight ends. But yeah, I think that's it. And the thing is, Haarberg and Sims they're run first quarterbacks right now. Let's be fair. And so this offense is all built on running the ball. If we can't run the ball successfully against Michigan, we're going to lose by a bunch. And so what more can you say? Am I missing any guys from the receiver room? No, I'm not missing a single dude. I named everyone who's on the stat sheet already, unless they're like a running back or something. I've named everyone. That's it. So the only thing that is frustrating me with them, besides everyone's playing hard. Look, this is what's frustrating me. Where's Janiron Bonner? Why is he listed as a fullback right now? We have Lindenmeyer and Liebenstritt playing fullback right now. And Janiron Bonner is a better athlete than every single wide receiver we have, minus maybe like Malachi Coleman. Okay, I've seen it in the hype videos of what Janiron Bonner's done in practice from last year in the spring. Why is he a fullback right now? Put him at tight end, put him at wide receiver, whatever. Like, I don't care where he is. He's better than – his potential is better than most of the guys in that room. And so I don't know what they're doing. And I don't live in Lincoln. I don't know any of the players unless they're, like, a senior. And that's only a couple guys. I don't really know what's going on. Maybe there's stuff I don't know. But Janiron Bonner is not being used, and he should be utilizing this offense right now. That's my one complaint right now. I'm going to stay off the O-line, too, because I think Ben Hart's improved, and then we would be starting Prochaska and maybe moving Corcoran to guard if Prochaska was healthy, but Corcoran should not be a tackle right now. He should be a guard. That's his best position. So I don't know what's going on there either. Hopefully Prochaska can make a comeback. He's probably – he's like 6'10". I don't know. Sometimes those taller linemen have trouble staying on the field, but – yeah, O-line's okay. They can run it, and that's nice. But, I'm going to do another podcast after the Michigan game. We can kind of see the rest of the season. But this game's going to show a lot for what this team is going to look like against a top 10 program. Not sure if Michigan's going to make the playoff this year. They might lose to Penn State. They might lose to Ohio State. But this will be a barometer to see just, you know, how tough this team is right now. And if they're able to stay close with Michigan, it's going to say a lot about this team making a bowl. So that's Nebraska. That's how I see us right now. If we keep it close into the fourth quarter, I'll be freaking out. And you never know what can happen in college football at that point. So I'll give us that. But that's Nebraska-Michigan preview for me. I know I've been rambling. So anyway. But we'll move on. Colorado, we got to talk about them. I know that it's a little bit old because they lost to Oregon last weekend, 42-6. But I think it's just the dynamic of everything going on with Colorado over the last month has been really fun. I did a Pac-12 preview video in like July with my friend Sam. And I said I thought Colorado had a legitimate chance to get 5-6 wins. And that's before, like, I didn't think they were going to be this good. I thought they had a chance to be a bowl team. But, you know, now they're, 3-1? So they have surprised me. And I was someone who was speaking higher of them than, like, 90% of people. Now, they were, like, Madden fans' favorite college football team. You know, the Madden video game, the most trash video game in football. The only one that right now, too, which is terrible. But, you know, people who are casual football fans, people who only really know NFL, Colorado fans that disappeared for two decades and then came back when Dion returned, like all those people were jumping on the bandwagon. So it's really awesome to see them generate all that buzz just because, you know, it's college football. It's a team in college football. I enjoy that. Yes, Nebraska doesn't like them, but I actually had fun when I went there a couple weeks ago, and I can talk about that too. It's just cool to see, like, pop culture was just straight up behind this team. It was hilarious. Some people were hating on Dion. I get it because he was getting so much attention, but they were fun. I just want to be fair to them. They survived Colorado State as well. They should have, I don't know, that Colorado State had a chance to go for two and win the game, and they didn't do it, and they took it to overtime or whatever, and they lost. So it was a really fun game to see. I was out that night watching the game with friends that I made down here, and it was like everyone is just like zoned in on this game, man. Like, doesn't matter if they even care about college football. That was wild to see. Like, it was one of the most watched college football games in a long time. So I was really rooting for Colorado State because my friend Boone went there. So I was a little bit bummed, but great game regardless. Also saw recently that, you know, there was that guy for Colorado State who like trucked Travis Hunter. It was Henry Blackburn, Colorado State safety. And a lot of people were, you know, sending him death threats and stuff, which is crazy. I guess he was from Boulder too. Blackburn was, but actually the two linked up recently and went bowling and hung out and kind of just did a whole video talking about how like it's more than just football for them. And so that was nice to see. I thought that was really cool, especially to have all the people who are negative about the situation kind of have a wake up call to be like, okay, yeah, maybe we shouldn't like come after people for, you know, especially like college students. It just looks goofy. So, but I knew Colorado was going to get checked at some point because even against Nebraska, like we sacked them like 8-9 times. Their run game is atrocious. Besides Shadur, like zipping it really fast at, you know, 2 to 3 seconds after he catches the snap or, you know, when he rolls out, they have good receivers too. But besides that, they don't have a whole lot. Their defense is undersized as well. And Oregon just absolutely exposed everything about them. And Shadur is kind of slow too. So they just sacked them a bunch. So Colorado, fun team, but they got checked. I mean, Colorado State is at best an average Mountain West team. So yeah, they got checked. And what else? With Colorado, I mean, they'll be fun to watch the rest of the year just because Dion generates that. And, you know, they went to College Game Day against Colorado State. ESPN College Game Day was there. I knew they did it then because I think even ESPN knew Colorado's, you know, magic was going to run out. So I could also give a whole story from when I went to Colorado, but I may save that for another podcast, actually. It's a whole story I have from when I went there a couple weeks ago. A lot of fun. Another thing, I was on the phone with my brother yesterday. We were talking about Colorado, Oklahoma. Those are, you know, our historic rivals. And what we were saying is that Nebraska needs to play Colorado and Oklahoma twice every 4 years, which we just did. We're about to do when we play them in, you know, Colorado next year. So it'll be all those teams in 4 years, which we should do every 4 to 6 years, I argue. But, you know, that I'm an idealist. Doesn't always work out that way. We're probably going to end up having a non-conference game against, like, well, who do we have in the future? I don't know. It's too far away, especially because we don't even know the Big Ten schedule next year because of all the additions from the Pac-12. Speaking of the Pac-12, they're on fire right now. Even after they've kind of beat up on each other last week when conference play started, they are on fire. USC, we'll start with them. They get all the fame because, you know, they're USC. Their offense is on fire. They're really fun to watch. Receivers, they got like 6 receivers who are like really good. Their run game is, I mean, it's not hard to run the ball when you got Caleb Williams back there. It's just like, all right, let's do a little distraction, right? So Caleb Williams should probably be in the NFL already, but he's still in college just chucking it around. Their defense is kind of mid, though. They killed Stanford. Arizona State made it a close game for a while with them, and Arizona State is bad. Okay? Arizona State gave USC trouble. This is one of the worst teams in the Power Five. Like, USC had trouble tackling. Like, Cameron Scadabo, the running back for Arizona State, caught a pass in the flat and just trucked, like, two people and ran all the way. I'm like, y'all can't tackle. I don't know. I don't believe in them. Still, I think their offense is awesome, but I don't think they're a championship team this year, of course. So they're on fire. They're going to play. Let's see. USC plays. They got this weekend. Did I even get them written down? They play somebody in the Pac-12 this weekend. Colorado. Oh, my gosh. Yeah, that's going to be an awesome game. It's big noon kickoff. I think they'll win over Colorado. Colorado is going to do the same thing Arizona State did, put up a whole lot of points. But USC's offense is going to be too good. They're going to win by maybe two scores or something like that. Maybe more, because Oregon basically just put out the whole, like, Oregon just exposed everything Colorado is. And so now it's going to be a lot easier for people to beat Colorado. I mean, Nebraska right now versus Colorado right now, we may still lose, but it would be a closer game. Doesn't matter, though. We got whacked a couple weeks ago. But, yeah, so that's fun. Oregon State is good. They lost by 3 to Washington State, though. Washington State's really fun. They, you know, beat Wisconsin by about 10 points 2 weeks ago. Cam Ward's awesome. Those receivers are awesome for them. They're out here making one-handed catches last week. Oregon State plays Utah tonight. I think it's going to be a close one. I'm taking Utah because their defense, by the way. Who else in the Pac-12? Oregon, obviously, is really good. They almost lost to Tech, which we could talk about Texas Tech later. And then we got Washington's passing attack. Washington doesn't even – this is the thing. And I respect it. Washington doesn't even try to run the ball at all. They're like, no. We got, like, five receivers who are great. We got Michael Penix Jr. Like, why would we run? And they're just chucking it around all game. It's awesome. I love it. So they're just having fun, you know, just chucking the ball around the field. And they, you know, they killed Michigan State last weekend, which doesn't say a lot. They're going to be fun this year. They're going to be competing to win the conference. UCLA looks tough as well. They got outlasted by Utah. It was just a slugfest of two, you know, I would say, defensive teams that can both run the ball as well. But, and Utah is my pick to win the conference. I'm going to stick with it. They did have a close game against Baylor, which is not a good look. Their defense is really good, though. And I love Jaquindon Jackson, their running back, as well. If you follow me on Twitter, you know that. Yeah. I don't know. I'm going to stick with Utah because I picked them to start. And maybe they have, like, the longevity to last, you know, physically as well through the conference. But it could go a lot of ways. I think Washington and Oregon might be the best team this year, too. Just because of their defense and offense combined. It's just awesome, both those teams. Utah's offense is kind of average. They can run it, but it's not crazy. We'll talk about the rest of college football as well. I was going to kind of go conference by conference, but I'm just going to talk about things that I predicted that have not surprised me, and then things that I did not predict that surprised me. So we'll start with what I did not predict that surprised me, because that's more fun. Colorado being as good as they are now, I guess I kind of predicted that at the same time. I thought they could get 5 to 6 wins. I was like, they're going to get 5 to 6. I believe that. They might get more. They also just got exposed. So maybe 5 to 6 was a really good pick. We'll see. North Carolina being good. I thought North Carolina would only be like an 8-win team this year, but they reloaded a lot of players on offense, and it, you know, Drake May's really good. He's going to be a top 10, top 5 quarterback in the draft. Coming up next year, I'll say top 10. We'll see. And they just reloaded on offense. Their defense is tough as well. They're going to be competing to win the ACC. I thought they'd be like a 8-9 win team this year, but they may be even better. BYU looks okay. And I thought they were going to be awful this year. I thought they'd be like a 3-4 win team, which is still possible because they're like 3-1. They beat Arkansas. I didn't see that coming at all. I thought Arkansas would do the same thing they did to them last year and just run over them. No, BYU looks – I mean, they got a lot of new players they're using on offense, and they look good. They lost to Kansas, but this might be the best Kansas team since, like, 2007. So, We'll see there. They're just trying to get to a bowl game. A lot of those Big 12 teams are just trying to get to a bowl game. I didn't see Oklahoma being good either. I thought they'd be like an 8-9 win team this year. And they look like the number two team in the Big 12, probably a 10-win team. Maybe better. We'll see. Their defense is tough. And I think they were kind of in like a Lincoln Riley hangover season last year. And now that he's gone, they've come more, you know, they're a defense first team. They have a really good defense. And Venables is a good coach. So I thought that Florida State loss looked bad for them last year in the bowl game, but it turns out that Florida State team now is one of the best in college football. I'd say top 10. Florida beat Tennessee 2 weekends ago. There was that picture of like the Tennessee football player and the Florida football player like squaring up. That was amazing. I only really watched the highlights of that. I don't even know what I was up to, but Florida beat Tennessee with their run game and their defense. Didn't see that coming. I thought Florida would be, especially after how Utah just shut them down, I thought Florida was maybe just scraping to get a bowl game this year. Looks like they're a tough team. Rutgers is okay right now, and I didn't see that coming. I thought Schiano was just going to be scrapping and eventually lose his job over the next couple years for Rutgers. And Rutgers looks okay. Like, they only put up, you know, one decent play on offense against Michigan and got a touchdown on their opening drive, and then they did nothing the rest of the game and lost 31-7. But they look okay. And that is a step forward for where they were in the past. I guess they had, when they had Vedrill in like 2021, they were kind of fun. That was their quarterback at the time. But yeah. So that surprised me. I didn't see that coming. Texas Tech, I thought, would be competing to win the Big 12 this year. Wyoming played out of their minds and beat them. So that happened. And I thought they were going to give Oregon everything they had, and they did. And they were one drive away from beating Oregon. And maybe 15 to 20 yards away from a field goal beating Oregon. And they had a Nebraska 2021 type loss where everything's going their way to close out the game. Fumble, return for a touchdown by Oregon, game over. And yeah, that's just been their season. They lost West Virginia by 7 last week, had a wide open guy in the end zone, missed him, and then they weren't able to convert on fourth down. They lost by 7, 20-13 to West Virginia on the road. I mean, West Virginia also surprised me a little bit this year. They look kind of shiesty, and they're not a good team by any means, but they could be a bowl team this year, which I didn't expect. Their defense looks tough, and I mean, who doesn't like when West Virginia is fun, you know? Who doesn't like that? I don't know who. Probably Pitt fans who also, you know, Pitt lost to West Virginia this year as well. And so Texas Tech's 1-3, and they're not going to compete to win the Big 12. So Oklahoma and Baylor. I already talked about Oklahoma. Baylor. Oh, no. Check that. Oklahoma State is who I meant to type here. Oklahoma State and Baylor. Thought they'd be bowl teams. Baylor, I saw as a 7-ish win team. Oklahoma State, 8, around that, maybe even 9 win team. That's what I saw. I thought Oklahoma State was going to have a bounce back season. No, not at all. Oklahoma State just lost to Iowa State, who I thought was the worst team in the conference. So now it's probably Oklahoma State, the worst team in the Big 12 now. They're bad. Their defense is bad. Their offense, they don't know who to put in at quarterback. They have good athletes. Ollie Gordon's a good running back. Jaden Bray is a good wide receiver. They got other guys I could even name. Good players. Stribling. You know, they got guys who can play. And they're just not doing anything about it. I think Gundy is in a tough spot. I know, I think they're 2-2. No, they're 2-2. They lost to South Alabama as well, which people were pooping on them for. South Alabama, you know, sometimes those Sun Belt teams will get you. Those teams probably aren't making bowls this year. Baylor just got – I know someone who went to Baylor, and I saw his Instagram post, and it was like – what was it? I don't even really look at Instagram that much anymore. But he posted – it was like what his friend posted of them all at the game, and they were like, just showed up for Baylor's funeral. This is the Texas game they had last weekend where they got, I don't even know what to use. They got destroyed by Texas last weekend, which I saw coming. I mean, Baylor's bad. Texas is the best Texas team since like the Colt McCoy era. The last thing I thought deserved some recognition, I didn't see this coming. Fresno State and Air Force are both tough teams this year. Fresno State's ranked number 25. I thought they would have a rebuilding year in the Mountain West after losing a lot of guys on offense from last year. They're the same team. They're tough. They destroyed Arizona State. Arizona State scored 0 points against Fresno State 2 weekends ago. And Air Force, I thought, you know, the same thing with them. And they're 4-0 as well. Wyoming also giving Texas a run for their money. I know they got blown out in that fourth quarter, but keeping it 10-10 with Texas going into the fourth is really impressive for a Mountain West team, especially Wyoming. They're not getting a lot of talent there. They're getting like 2 stars, maybe a couple 3 stars in transfers, and then everyone else is just some big cowboy out there who's playing for them. They're just a ragtag bunch of players. I love Wyoming. I wish I could do my whole – I probably don't have the time, but I wish I could just do a whole podcast talking about Wyoming football, and I might, just because I think they're really interesting. I could get into it. Most of y'all probably don't care. Moving on. Things that I predicted, I could just run through this real quick. Georgia being boringly good. Yeah, playing three, you know, group of five schools to start out your season, I guess – South Carolina as well, a team they struggled against. They're good, but it's like boring. And no one on their team jumps off the stat sheet either. They just throw people out there like, oh, you're a 5-star. Just go out there and play and then we'll win. So they're boring to me. Notre Dame, I knew they'd be tough. Hartman's the best quarterback they've had there, I'd say, since maybe the best quarterback they've had there in a long, long time. So they were very close to beating Ohio State and maybe should have beaten Ohio State. And they dropped an interception, and they also had plays where they only had 10 guys on defense, especially the last play of the game. They're really close to being undefeated if they don't lose to Ohio State in a close one. They're going to have their chance to win out from here. I told a Notre Dame fan last week, and I said, don't be down on yourself. Y'all are really good. They are a really good team. I knew Duke was going to be good too. That's who they play this weekend. Not sure who I'm going to pick. I'm going to have to do it on the whim here in a little bit. Duke is fun. What they did to Clemson, I called it. You can go check the last podcast I did. That was sweet. This is a really fun team. They have a lot of veterans on offense, a lot of experience on top of Riley Leonard, their quarterback. I like this Duke team. Kansas is fun again. I don't even need to get into why they're fun again. They're going to give Texas a solid game this weekend. I'll say that. If you watch college football, Jalen Daniels is all I got to say. Luke Grimm's also fun at wide receiver. Devin Neal, running back. They're awesome. I love watching them play. Pac-12, we already got into that. I knew they were going to be good. Clemson being average. And when I say average, I'm talking about Clemson standards of average. Losing a close one to Florida State and, I guess, getting blown out by Duke, that was – okay, yeah. No, they are average right now, okay? They should have beat Florida State, I would argue. And they had no business beating Duke because they just fumbled everything they had in that game. Yeah. Clemson can go get 9 wins this year, potentially. They play Syracuse this weekend, which is a team that's given them trouble in the past. They can still go get 9 wins. They have the talent on the team to do that. They need to use the transfer portal in the future as well, I would say. Florida State being good, why did I even write that down? I don't even need to write. Everyone thought Florida State would be good, especially when they got Keon Coleman at wideout from Michigan State, the transfer. He has like hella touchdowns this year already. No one needs to hear me say that. Everyone knew Virginia Tech and UVA would be really bad this year. I don't even need to say that. I thought Pitt would be average too. Jurkovec, their quarterback, looks like Ben Roethlisberger back there. Dude's slow. And then Big Ten West being a mess is another thing I wrote down. But, it's been a mess. So these are things that don't even need to be mentioned. We will move on to doing the weekend picks for all the games, and then we'll be done with the pod today. We'll start it out. Utah at Oregon State. I'm calling a Utah win by 3 to 6 points. Going to be a tough one. I'm going to try to watch this game. I said Utah wins 30 to 27, something like that. Cincinnati at BYU. I think BYU could have a rebound game, but I think this is one of those weird Friday night games where something crazy happens. I think Cincinnati has a lot of fun on offense, and I think Corey Kiner has a big game for them. Their defense is tough. They held Oklahoma to 20 points. I'm saying Cincinnati wins this game at BYU. USC Colorado, already kind of gave my pick. I think USC wins in a shootout. They also could win by 20 or something. Florida Kentucky, I'm picking Florida because of their run game. I think they're good. They got wrecked by Utah, obviously, early in the season, but I think they'll win a close one over Kentucky on the road. Texas A&M at Arkansas, or I guess this one's not even – I guess they're technically the road team. It's in AT&T Stadium, the Cowboys Stadium. It's going to be really close. Arkansas, once again, should win. I think A&M has a good game, finds a way to win. I would take Arkansas, but they lost to BYU, and that just doesn't look good. I'm taking A&M, close one, maybe even overtime, three-point win. Louisiana versus Minnesota, and the reason I'm calling this game as a pick, because I was originally going to pick Louisiana to win this game. After Minnesota had their loss to Northwestern, I have to flip it back because I think they had a trap game at Northwestern and lost. This was their trap game. I think they have a good rebound. They beat Louisiana, which I, in the summertime, I picked this as the trap game for Minnesota. I say Minnesota wins. That new running back they have, I think it's like Darius Taylor, freshman. Could have got his name wrong. Kind of generic football name. He looks really good. He's going to pop off this year, and they're going to be trying to hold on to him with NIL money. And they don't have that at Minnesota either. Clemson at Syracuse. I'm picking Clemson to win a close one. You never know what's going to happen in that dome stadium in New York. Clemson's, especially after last week, which that was a colossal meltdown. They're going to find a way to get away. Georgia at Auburn. Georgia's winning. Not even going to entertain this. It's like they're going to have a boringly nice win. Like they'll win 24 to like 13. Michigan at Nebraska, 20 to 17, Michigan win. I really wanted to pick Nebraska, obviously, because this is a Nebraska podcast. I'm picking the best case scenario, a 3-point loss for Nebraska, which is going to make some people mad. Whatever. Kansas at Texas. I say Kansas. Look, Texas should win this game. And I know people don't like to use the word should win in college football. Texas should win. And I'm picking Kansas to win because I'm crazy and I just want to have fun with it. Like Jared Casey, 2-point conversion to end the game. Game tying touchdown, 2-point conversion. Boom. Kansas wins 43-42, last play of the game. Call me crazy. The reason I'm putting this next one up, it's not even going to be a contest. Indiana at Maryland. The reason I'm bringing this game up, I'm picking Maryland, by the way, not even putting thought into it. Don't even need to. I think Tom Allen this is last year at Maryland. I remember seeing a video of the locker room at Indiana where he was trying to pump them up before the Purdue game and their final game last year. It was so cringe. Oh my gosh. I had a podcast in the wintertime and we went over that, I think. Kind of talked about that. He had an even more cringe video last weekend where they had like their locker room, all the players singing like their whatever fight song they have. They're like, Indiana, Indiana. And he was trying to be like a choir leader. He was like, and you can see like the cringe, like some guys on the team are like Indiana, they're real bad this year. They needed like a quadruple overtime game to beat Akron. And they play Maryland, they're going to get killed. They're not going to win another game this year. They might beat Michigan State if they get lucky. Besides that, they're losing every game they have left on their schedule. If you want to go look at their schedule, go look at their schedule. And Tom Allen's out of there. None of those players want to play for him anymore. I don't know why I'm hating on him, but he's just cringe. I can't do it. Purdue at Illinois. The reason I put this game on here is because it's like, these are the two teams in the Big Ten that just don't matter. Obviously, Nebraska doesn't matter. It hasn't mattered since, like, Bo Pelini was there, pretty much. But like Purdue, they're just like there. And so is Illinois. Like their fan bases are small and they're just there. And so it's just like they are almost the same team to me. So I like Purdue and Illinois. It's like the battle of like who's less irrelevant in terms of like just the brand that they have. I'm picking Purdue to win. I think Hudson Card is a fun quarterback. They're 1-3 right now. They lost to Fresno State. They lost last weekend to Wisconsin. I think Purdue has fun game. Shootout, 36-35, two-point conversion in overtime. I know I'm calling crazy stuff right now, but why not have fun with these predictions? Purdue wins. Hudson Card's a better quarterback than Luke Altmyer. That's my call. Houston at Texas Tech. The reason I'm putting this game up, this game is irrelevant. They're both teams are bad right now. But it's a fun matchup that those two are playing each other. I know they're going to be playing each other a bunch going forward. I'm going to take Texas Tech. They're at home. They need the win. They had some close losses. They're going to get the win here. Baylor at UCF. I'm putting this up because this is a rematch of the 2014 Fiesta Bowl. I think that was the year where UCF beat Baylor. People didn't see that coming. And I think UCF wins again against Baylor. Baylor's offense is pretty subpar, and UCF has a fun offense. UCF wins that one. Boise State at Memphis. I have this one on the list because these are two fun group of five schools. Memphis had a close loss to Missouri last weekend. Boise State is a fun team too. I'm going to pick Boise State to win. I like them. It's going to be a close one. LSU at Ole Miss. This is a good game. Ole Miss, they got checked against Bama last weekend. Bama's defense showed up. LSU, I think they're going to reach the playoff this year if they can win the SEC West and also beat Georgia, which I think they can also do if they get it together. Picking LSU to win, close game, shootout. Oregon at Stanford. I'm just putting this on the list because it's the last time these two schools play each other for a long time. Picking Oregon. Don't even need to explain why. Iowa State at Oklahoma, same story. Oklahoma blowout win. Absolute blowout. Fun game Saturday night. Notre Dame at Duke. I'm picking Duke in a close one. Duke's better than I thought they were going to be, too. I thought they'd be a 9-win team, and they're better than I thought after what they've done so far. I'm picking Duke in a close one. Yeah, it's going to be close. Notre Dame, a little bit better team. We'll see. Give me an awesome game. South Carolina, Tennessee. I'm picking Tennessee to have a bounce back win. They got blown out by South Carolina last year. Think they'll get a close win. Michigan State at Iowa. This is a battle of like two just, I would say, down bad football teams. Iowa had a shutout loss to Penn State, 31-0. Michigan State is in shambles right now. Mel Tucker was a fraud. We don't even need to get into it. I mean, that's why Keon Coleman and Peyton Thorne transferred, you know, in the offseason. I knew someone was up there. They're really bad, too. Iowa is also really bad on offense. Their defense is not as good as last year. They're still really good. But I say this, I think Michigan State has an upset win. It's a night game. I know. Kinnick Stadium night game. Tough to win those. I think Michigan State finds a way to make it chaotic. And with their run game with Nathan Carter, they're able to make it a close game. Iowa's offense is so bad that they find a way to lose against Michigan State. Embarrassing loss. Michigan State gets it together and wins. That's my like bold pick for the weekend, by the way. West Virginia at TCU. I'm picking TCU because their offense has enough weapons. They had a good win against SMU. West Virginia is fun. Could be a scrap fest. It will be, actually. With West Virginia, it's the only way they can win. TCU wins, though. Bama at Mississippi State. Mississippi State is not going to win this. They don't have the team. They lost South Carolina last weekend as well. Bama has a tough defense and a good run game. They're going to win. Could be fun for a half. Washington and Arizona is the last pick. I'm picking, you know, I'm doing some of these games. I guess Arizona's 3-1, so they deserve it. They deserve to be on the list. Arizona, I think, has a fun one. Makes it interesting for a while. It's a home game for them. But at the end of the day, it's the Washington offense in warm weather, and they're just going to chuck it, and they're going to score points, and they're going to win. As simple as that. Romo Odunze is really good as well for them at wide receiver. So those are my picks for the weekend. I could get into, you know, a little bit of reaction on Sunday. I'm going to try to drop another podcast on the Michigan-Nebraska game, cover some other stuff. Excited about the weekend, man. I'm about to go to work here in a little bit. Just want to talk about all these games. I got this on eBay, this jacket on eBay for like $5 last year. Love this jacket. I'm happy to have it. Devaney is in the mix back here. Devaney, hey. Hey, Devaney. Oh, she just woke up. What's up, baby? What's up, baby? That's my dog. You probably couldn't see her here. There we go. She just woke up from her nap. I just woke her up. Anyway, that's a football podcast. We just talk about college football for like an hour, probably. I love it. Let's do a quick shout out. Honestly, I'm trying to get sponsors. I'm doing a podcast. This candle's rolling, by the way. But I want to give a quick shout out to Dr. Squatch soap. And I mean, they're just called Dr. Squatch. They also have candles. I got a candle. I did a, you know, a big package Labor Day. They had a Labor Day sale. Got a big package, bars of soap, exfoliating bars of soap. They're amazing. They also have candles, deodorant. It's all these different men's products. They're sweet. This candle is rolling, by the way. But this is, what is that, Alpine Sage? This is awesome. I might just show y'all all my different Dr. Squatch stuff. This is awesome. Smells good, even though my sense of smell is garbage. I like only smell good things. If it's a bad smell, I can barely smell it. If it's a good smell, I can barely smell it. I think, I don't know what happened to me, but let me show y'all my soap real quick before we're out of here. This is why I can't take my podcasts like too serious. Like, I do put effort into this. I do have fun with this. In the future, when I have more time, I want to try to make it more like professional, I guess, like try to make it more like the production quality be better. I'd like to eventually use like a camera and have a microphone and all of that. If I do keep it going, but it's just so much, maybe I'm lazy, but like, it's just so much easier to just pull up these headphones, sit the laptop down, be able to just pick up the you know, whatever, the laptop, and just have fun with it. Like that, I do this for fun. I'm not trying to make it big. Like, it could maybe get big if I was more serious about it. It's just like a fun thing. Anyway, I'm trying to get sponsored by Dr. Squatch soap right now. So maybe I should make it bigger. But yeah, I'll show y'all some of my soap bars. I just kind of give them a promotion real quick. Maybe they'll, you know, help me out someday. So I guess I could kind of tell a story, but when I was like middle school, high school, early high school, I didn't take care of my skin the way I should have, and had some, I would say, I don't even know how to get into it. I don't want to sound gross, but basically I figured out that I needed to take care of my skin or else. And so every time I take a shower, I use this soap, and it, you know, it has exfoliating beads in the soap bar itself. I'll show you this one. This is Divine Storm, which actually you can't even get right now because they sold out. It's Thor on there. They have a Marvel sponsor, so they're able to use Thor. So it's a sweet bar of soap and smells amazing. I'm going to let her nap. I'll leave her alone. Smells amazing. Love it. So I always try to get, whenever I run out, I make sure to get a new box of this soap. It is kind of expensive. It was about $7-$8 a bar of soap. But if you do, you know, you can, what they'll do, if you do enough orders, every time you get an order, you get a free bar of soap with your next order. And you also can get different discounts depending on holidays. They'll even sometimes, like, they gave me a whole discount one time. They just texted me through the messenger thing on there, and I got a whole discount for like a lot of soap. And so if you do it enough, it does pay off. If you want to take care of your skin, I got another one. This one's Fresh Falls Grapefruit IPA. These are some of their common ones. Birchwood Breeze. It's also on the website. Free Solo Scrub. This, you can't get this anymore. They ran out of this one too. This was a one-time thing. Y'all probably aren't even watching at this point. Bay Rum, look at that. These are awesome, dude. I'm just going to pull it out. It's just satisfying, man. These are so, look at that. It's just a box of clean, and it takes care of your skin. This is not that spring green stuff that is actually bad for your skin, makes you have rashes. This is all natural men's soap, and it smells awesome, takes care of you. I use it every day. So, and if I don't, then I have problems. So there's other soaps I've used too. I'll go to the local store and get soap occasionally. But, you know, if I get a sponsorship from Dr. Squatch, I won't be doing that anymore. So there you go. I just wanted to give them a shout out because they're cool to me. Anyway, that's everything. Nebraska, we're pulling off an upset this weekend. Just kidding. I was completely joking about the score prediction. 30-21, Nebraska, we're winning against Michigan. Go Big Red, run the damn ball. We're out.